Hello, everybody. Welcome to a new episode of the Dissenter. I'm your host, Ricardo Lopes, and today I'm joined by Dr. Robert Kelly. He is Professor of Archaeology at the University of Wyoming. Dr. Kelly has shaped and contributed much to our understanding of hunter-gatherer societies. He has a deep interest in Western North American archaeology, especially in the Great Basin area. By examining the Pleistocene colonization of the Americas, by examining artifacts and lithic technology, Dr. Kelly reconstructs past lifeways and compares them to current foraging societies, and examines human adaptation to climate change during different periods in the past. He's the author of books like The Foraging Spectrum, Diversity in Hunter-Gatherer Lifeways, and The Fifth Beginning: What 6 Million Years of Human History Can Tell Us About Our Future. So, Dr. Kelly, thank you a lot for taking the time to come on the show. It's a pleasure to have you on.
I'm happy to be here.
Okay, great. So, recently, I've released an interview with Dr. Lynn Wadley, and we talked a little bit about archaeology and how it is a little bit speculative in some ways as a discipline because we have incomplete data. Sometimes we only have fragments and we have to make interpretations based on those fragments that we have, on the remains that we have at our disposal. So, the first question I would like to ask you is, taking into account these inherent limitations of archaeology, what is it like to be an archaeologist? Because, perhaps from a scientific perspective.
Being an archaeologist can be a great deal of fun, and it can be very exciting, but it can also be equally frustrating because it is so difficult for us to reconstruct what happened in the past. We often compare archaeologists to detectives who are confronted with a crime scene. And they often find it hard to reconstruct what happened at that crime scene, even though they presumably are at that crime scene soon after the events. They seal it off so that nobody touches anything, hopefully. And they understand everything that they're looking at. They know what chairs are and tables and windows and cups, and they understand all of these things. And they can still find it hard to reconstruct what happened at this place. So imagine if your crime scene is 20,000 years old and it's been messed around in by other people and by animals, and you don't really know what exactly some of these things are that you pick up. It's a really difficult job. And humility is the best posture for an archaeologist.
Yeah, I understand. And wouldn't you agree that archaeology has and will always have kind of a subjective element to it, in the sense that, the things that you look at, the remains that you get, you have to interpret what they are about, how they were used, and also because we always come from our own cultural framework, and we have to be careful about that, right?
I see that there's really two ways to go about doing archaeology. One way is to try and use archaeology as a time machine to go back in time and reconstruct what you would see at this site if you could go back in time and stand there and watch what was happening. That's one way to do archaeology. The other way is to use what I think is archaeology's strength. Archaeology's strength is its ability to look at the evidence of human behavior over vast spans of time and space. And we're the only field that can do this. Historians don't do this. They tend to focus on very particular areas, particular time periods. Archaeologists often have this very broad view in time and space. And that's where archaeology is really strong. That's where the patterns that we see, I think, are telling us something that we can reliably interpret. When we start focusing down more and more and more on a single site, a single layer, and try and interpret that, what we find there in a lot of detail, in a lot of ethnographic-like detail, the probability that we're wrong goes up.
Yeah.
For the exact reasons that you just gave. We find things and we don't know exactly what they are. We can find things like rock art or carvings in stone or in bone, and we can look at those and we can say, well, this thing rather obviously had a meaning for whoever created it and whoever looked at it. Somebody understood what that meant, but we'll probably never get there to what that thing means. But we can be certain, we can rest assured, that this object was important, did have meaning. So we can look at the distribution of that object, whatever it is, a certain kind of figurine, for example, over time and space, and use it as a way to talk about the distribution over time of a particular belief system, whatever that belief system was, or the distribution over space of a group of people who all belong to the same culture. And we can look at changes in the size of an area covered by people who considered themselves part of the same culture. Now, that's not as exciting as me picking up a figurine and telling you, oh, this is an Earth Mother Goddess figurine. That's a more exciting story, but I have no idea if that story is correct.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, and we tend to love narratives, right?
So we tend to love narratives, and sometimes in archaeology, we can create narratives, and we can see very, very detailed pictures. The best example is from Europe, is the Ötzi, the 5,000-year-old man who was found in the mountains in the Alps in Italy. We can reconstruct this man's last 24 hours in amazing detail. If we could go back in time with the information we have, I think we could find out who killed him, because he was in fact murdered. Mm-hmm. And we could find his killer with the information we have. It's that fine-grained. But the opportunities to do that in archaeology are few and far between.
Mm-hmm. And wouldn't you also say that archaeology also works at the intersection of the humanities with some what we could call hard sciences like climatology and geology and biology, mm-hmm. and others?
Always. In the United States, archaeology is part of anthropology. Mm-hmm. And we often say that anthropology is the most humanistic of the sciences and the most scientific of the humanities. And it really is. It's both of those fields. You can find archaeologists who are doing textual analysis of artifacts, similar to what literary scholars might do. And then you can find other archaeologists who are doing hard science, stable isotope analyses of human tooth enamel, for example. We have both kinds of people in the field. And I really think that it's best if we have both of those kinds of people. I like to think of the humanistic side of archaeology. That's the heart and soul of archaeology. It tells us why we do what we do. And the scientific side of archaeology is our hands. It's how we go about achieving those more humanistic goals.
I understand. So I would like to focus a big chunk of our interview on your recent book, The Fifth Beginning. And there you talk about, as the title implies, five different beginnings in human evolution and history, like, for example, the beginning of technology, the beginning of culture, beginning of agriculture, the beginning of a political organization called the state. And we will leave the fifth beginning for later. But starting with the first one, when did technology begin?
Let me begin by saying when I wrote that book, I was trying to take what I see as the strength of archaeology, its ability to look at patterns over vast reaches of space and time, and use it to its maximum power, to look at all of human evolution and look for times when there were very pervasive, definitive, no turning back sort of changes in the human signature on the planet. And those are signaling a very major shift in the nature of human life. Mm-hmm. So stepping back from human history as back as we possibly can to look at the whole range of human history from 6 million years ago when we split off from the apes up until today, I ask myself, when are there changes in the signature of humanity that are signaling a change in the nature of human life? And I really saw four in the past, four major changes, and then there's a fifth one that I think we're in the middle of now. Mm-hmm. The first one is technology. And that shows up in the archaeological record as stone tools. Yeah. And the most definitive evidence is about 2.5 to 2.6 million years ago. There is some earlier evidence, but there is some debate over exactly what the nature of that evidence is and the dating of it. So it could be earlier, but definitely by 2.5 million years ago, our human ancestors, one of them, because there were a number of options out there, were using stone tools. Now we don't know exactly which one is using them, but one of them is definitely using stone tools. We don't know exactly what they're using those tools for. It's most likely, because of the context that they're found in, they're most likely processing animal carcasses. Mm-hmm. It could be animals that they were hunting, but it may also be animals that they were scavenging. Mm-hmm. Because other carnivores that would have been present in this savanna-like environment that our ancestors evolved in would have left behind a fair amount of food in these carcasses, especially if you can break open the bones and get to the marrow inside. Possibly you'd have to chase away some of the hyenas or the lions, but if you could do that, there's a fair amount of food on these scavenged carcasses. They may also have been hunting. It's difficult for us to figure out if that's what was actually happening.
Mm-hmm. Right. And I imagine that another very important piece of technology that we acquired during our revolutionary history was fire.
It's fire. Absolutely. Fire can provide warmth at night. It can provide protection because other predators don't like fire. And it can cook food. And we know that cooked meat is more nutritious than raw meat. And cooked meat does a lot of the work for us. Instead of relying on our bodies to just break down the raw meat, the cooked meat introduces already partially broken down food into the human system, which means that frees up energy for the body to devote elsewhere. And we sort of see, right, when we think fire is being used, there's a shift in the size of the human gut. It becomes smaller because it doesn't have to be so big to process food. And we see an increase in the size of the brain. So it may be that we now could free up energy to devote it to other sorts of tasks. It didn't necessarily mean that the brain would get bigger, but it did mean that natural selection had some excess energy that it could work with.
Mm-hmm. Do we know exactly when hominins first used fire? Because as you were talking about our guts decreasing in size and our brains increasing and so on, if I'm not mistaken, wasn't it Homo erectus, the first hominin, that really got a big boost in terms
Yes.
of brain size?
Yes. And that may have been when they started using fire to cook food, but we don't know for certain. It's a very, very difficult. Depending on who you talk to, they'll say there's definitive evidence by 300,000 years ago. There's other evidence at 700,000 years. There's at least one possible hearth in South Africa that's about a million years old. This is one of those things that's very difficult for archaeologists to extract from the record. Mm-hmm. So we just don't know the answer to that question with any security.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So you refer to the second beginning as being the beginning of culture, but I would like to ask you, isn't technology also part of culture?
It, of course, depends on how you want to define the word culture.
Okay.
And for me, the definition that I use is some abstract understanding of how the world is supposed to operate. What's the proper thing to do with a life? What's the proper thing for males to do, for females to do, for old people to do, for young people to do? What should be your goal in life? Be very kind to your relatives. Make a lot of money. These are all things that our culture defines for us. Here's what you ought to be doing with your life. Technology obviously plays an enormous role in human life, but that's not. You can be cultural without technology, and just because you have technology doesn't mean you're a cultural being. So it's culture is, I mean, technology is obviously important to human life, but it's, from in my definition, it's not essential to the definition of culture.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I asked you that because I was imagining that at least throughout most of our evolutionary history, the kinds of technology that we developed were transmitted through the generations, right? And mm-hmm. were part of the information that we transmitted to each other in
yeah.
our several different communities and societies. So, I mean, that would be a part of what we consider culture.
It's the transmission of information from generation to generation is obviously essential to culture. It's how cultures get transmitted over time. Mm-hmm. It's also partly how they change over time.
Yeah.
But simply because you're transmitting information from one generation to another doesn't mean that you're cultural. So the transmission of information from one generation to another is necessary in order for a culture to be propagated, but the presence of the transmission of information is not sufficient to define a being as having culture. There are animal species that transmit such information from one generation to the next, but they're not cultural.
Mm-hmm.
They don't have an abstract understanding of how the world is supposed to work. They don't live in a world where forest spirits could have an impact on you. They don't live in a world where there are things like witches or wizards or dragons, or they just don't live in that world. So the transmission of information is necessary to a cultural system, but it's not the only part of it. It's what's being transmitted, and not the fact that information is being transmitted. That's crucial, from my perspective of culture.
Okay. And do you agree that there are other animals, particularly, for example, primates, that also have culture, even though not cumulative culture as we do?
No. No, simple answer is no. I haven't seen any evidence that they have culture the way that we do. That said, it's extremely difficult for us to understand how other primates are actually thinking. But I don't see any evidence that they have an abstract understanding of how the world is supposed to operate. They have an understanding of the world around them. They can understand, a primate can understand that this, a chimpanzee can understand that this chimpanzee is favorably disposed to me, and this one is above me in the hierarchy. They can understand all that, obviously, but there isn't some abstract understanding of what the world is behind all of that.
I understand. Okay, and so, because later on in the interview I'm going to ask you about evolutionary approaches in anthropology, and particularly applied to human behavior and the human mind, I would like to ask you when we talk about culture, sometimes people separate culture from our biology, right? So they deal with culture as if it's something separate from our genes, our brains, whatever. But you agree that for us to have culture, we have to set in place some cognitive mechanisms that would have allowed for it.
Absolutely. The capacity to be cultural has something to do with a rewiring of the human mind. And we frankly don't know what that is. And we don't know exactly when it happened, although I suspect it was fairly recently in human evolution. But there's a rewiring of the mind is obviously a biological change, which implies that it's some change in the genetic composition of humans that happened at some time in the past that allowed us to think about the world very differently. Yeah. I think Steve, the archaeologist, Steve Mithen, the British archaeologist, Steve Mithen, I think he came closest when he said the mind operates in terms of these four major modules, a natural history module, a social organization module, a linguistic module, and a technology module. Mm-hmm. And those could all operate independently of one another without interacting with one another. And culture entailed some rewiring of the mind that allowed each of these modules to now tap into the other module. Mm-hmm. And it's what allows us to use, for example, natural history in order to talk about social organization or the nature of people. It's really what allows us to use metaphors so that I can say Sam is crafty as a fox. And if you're not somebody who can understand metaphors, and all humans can understand metaphors, that statement would make no sense whatsoever. Now, that statement would make no sense to someone in a culture who doesn't consider foxes to be crafty. In American culture, yes, we consider foxes to be crafty. I don't know if that extends into European culture as well. But everyone, I could make that statement, drawing a link between a human and the natural world, And as long as you're in a culture that understands what how we think about foxes, it makes complete sense. It makes perfect sense. But somebody who can't link this sort of social organization module with a natural history module would walk away thinking, what are you talking about? How can a human be like a fox? They're different. So culture is what allows us to make these linkages between these different information pools in the mind. I don't know if Maithan is right, but I think he's close to it.
I would indeed have, would love to have him on the show
Yeah.
because, he has a very interesting theory, I guess,
Yeah. Yeah.
in terms of the modularity of the mind and so on.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, another question. So, with the advent of agriculture, of not agriculture, sorry, with the advent of culture, we also had a new phenomenon in our revolutionary history, that is gene culture coevolution, in the sense that a culture also started being part of our environment and started also creating selective pressures. And we have some evidence of some cases where culture even changed our bodies. So, are you also interested in that bit, in that phenomenon of gene culture coevolution?
That's not an area that I've really done any research in, but it's correct that once you have culture and this capacity to sort of think about the world very differently, that those ideas then become part of the human phenotype, and in addition to height and stature and nose shape and everything else. Body proportions, our ideas about how the world operates can will would have an effect on which cultures are going to be successful in an evolutionary sense. That doesn't mean that they're good or that they're desirable. You can have extremely militaristic cultures who believe the purpose in a man's life is to wreak havoc on your neighbors and steal from them. That could end up being a very successful strategy in the short term and could result in the biological propagation of a particular set of genes of the people carrying those ideas. I would say later on we'd find that that approach to life ultimately would be unsuccessful, but that's for a later discussion. But it absolutely, once you have culture, you introduce a whole new element to the nature of evolutionary change. And you don't have to rely as much on biology for your success.
That's
I
for
mean, we
sure.
humans could now move into very, very cold environments without having to make that movement entirely with only biological apparatus. You can now manufacture all kinds of clothing, and the groups who live in the north, like the Inuit, have remarkable knowledge about how to manufacture warm clothing. You can do that without a great deal of change in body's shape. There is some. We know that that's the people who live in the north have different body proportions, but they're not like other animals in the who adapt to the north. They can do it through cultural ideas.
I guess that a very interesting metaphor perhaps would be the one that Richard Dawkins put forth when he talked about the extended phenotype. I guess that in the case of humans, we could talk about culture as a sort of extended phenotype, because it is something, it is a tool that we have that is apart from our body, but we can also use to survive and reproduce and be evolutionarily successful.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Okay, so let's go to the third beginning, that is the beginning of agriculture. I mean, there are several different complications with this bit, because am I right to say that people are not yet sure why hunter-gatherers adopted agriculture? I mean, definitely why they started creating settlements and moving from a nomadic style of life to a sedentary life?
Yeah, I'd say that the field is still debating this. And like the study of many scientific problems usually goes through some kind of phases where you think it's this, and then no, you overturn that and you have a completely different idea. And then somebody overturns that with either a completely different idea, or they say, actually, that the original idea may have been closer to the truth. So the study of the origins of agriculture has certainly gone through this back in the 60s. And if we go back into the 1940s or 50s, the overwhelming idea was that agriculture was just reflected the development of the human mind and our capacity to understand how plants reproduce, and that once that happened, the little light bulb goes on over someone's head, and boom, they become agriculturalists, because that's the next step in human evolution. That idea was sort of thrown out in the 1960s, based on the fact that we know that many hunter-gatherers know about agriculture, and yet they're not agriculturalists. And we know that the practice of agriculture begins in a number of areas in the world, but it often takes 1,000, 2,000 years for these hunter-gatherers to fully shift from being hunter-gatherers with maybe a little bit of agriculture to being full-time agriculturalists. That just doesn't fit with that earlier idea. So by the 1960s and 70s, the reigning idea was that it was population. The population grows, it pushes up against the carrying capacity of a hunting and gathering economy, and so they had to make that environment produce more food. That idea has then come under criticism in the last 20 years or so, with people arguing there's no evidence for population growth and population pressure prior to the appearance of agriculture. So there must have been some other process at work. The idea that some people propose here is something called niche construction, where people are actively trying to construct their environments, and part of that effort results in the production of more food from an environment. I've never found niche construction theory to be very interesting, and it's often contrasted with the paradigm that I work in, human behavioral ecology, when in fact it's completely compatible with that framework. So I've quite frankly been a little bit baffled by the people who pursue it and say that human behavioral ecology is incorrect. They're absolutely correct, though, that people do construct their environments, that the human interaction with the environment has an effect on that environment, and then consequently people have to respond to this new environment that's constructed by the human use of that environment. One of the ways that happens is by the exploitation of high-ranked resources, resources that provide you with a lot of food value for the time that you put into exploiting them. If you do that enough, and if population continues to grow even a little bit, you'll eventually reduce the availability of those resources, and you'll have to expand the things that you consider food on that environment. One of those things that would be included are small seeds from wheat, from barley in the Near East, from teosinte in Mexico, from rice in Southeast Asia. And these are plants that initially probably had low return rates, didn't provide people with a lot of food value for the time that you would have to put into exploiting them. But some of those plants respond to human use of them. Mm-hmm. And some of that may be unintentional, and some of it may be, is almost certainly intentional. People save the bigger seeds and plant them. And consequently, they'll take a resource like wild wheat or wild barley, and they'll convert it into something that's more productive. When they've made it more productive, they increase its return rate, and of course we would then expect people to start exploiting it more heavily than some other resources. It basically jumps the queue in the ranking of resources, and so you focus more time on it. And it's a resource that you can actually make more productive, unlike some other resources out there on the environment that are very difficult for humans to make more productive. It's hard to make, for example, here in North America, it's hard to make deer a more productive resource on the landscape. Mm-hmm. So people, it makes sense to me that even if you have a slightly growing population, and I don't think it takes extreme population growth for hunter-gatherers to feel pressure. You don't need a massively crowded environment for somebody to say, well, let's shift from hunting and gathering to agriculture. It really takes very small numbers of people for hunter-gatherers to start to feel a pressure on their food base. So it wouldn't take much. It doesn't take large numbers of people. There have now been other analyses, especially in the eastern United States, which suggest that the evidence for a growing population and an expansion of the diet breadth precedes the agriculture of some native plants like sumpweed and sunflower, but also it precedes the heavy use of maize agriculture. Mm-hmm. So I think agriculture is at one scale, if we step back far enough, agriculture is a product of population growth and subsequent population pressure on the available resources in a region. If you zoom down and look at the process in any one area, it's going to have a little more factors to it and be a little more detailed. But at the large scale, at the scale I look at it in the fifth beginning, I think it's largely population growth and subsequent population pressure.
Mm-hmm. Right. So I will try to be careful while introducing this next question, because by reading your books, one thing that I learned is that when we use the term hunter-gatherer, we can't really say or think that hunter-gatherer is something that is homogeneous across all hunter-gatherer societies, so that we have to approach them on a one-to-one basis or something like that, because they differ from one another. But I mean, isn't it also the case that at least in general, when people moved from hunter-gatherer societies to agricultural-based ones, that there were, at least in the short run, some negative consequences, like, for example, they had worse nutrition. There is evidence, for example, with children's skeletons that they had diminished in stature, for example. Their societies changed drastically in terms of organization. It was after agriculture that we created the first chiefdoms and then states, and so societies became much more stratified and hierarchical. And we tend to associate hunter-gatherers with more egalitarianism, let's say, and people also had to work harder to produce their food. I mean, I'm referring to several different examples of things that people present, anthropologists namely, present as short-term, let's say, negative consequences that the adoption of agriculture had on human societies. Do you agree with that or not?
Well, certainly the evidence, especially from human skeletal remains, shows that agriculture solved some problems, but it also created new problems. This is sort of the nature of life, right? Computers solved a lot of problems for us, but they also created new problems, eye strain, for example. And that doesn't stop us from using them, because there are other tasks that I suppose we place are more important to us than the health of our eyes. Or they then cause us to let's develop new technology in order to reduce the eye strain of using computers. So agriculture solved problems, created new ones. And we can see this happening. There's a reduction in stature. There's an increase in work, and the increase in work seems to fall especially onto women. There's a decrease in dental health. I can look at a human skull and just look at the teeth, and I'll tell you if it's a hunter-gatherer or an agriculturalist. Because a hunter-gatherer will probably have all their teeth, although they may be worn down considerably. But an agriculturalist, they'll have lost many of their teeth
And
because
you would also probably have more cavities.
they've lost many of the teeth because of cavities, because of the high carbohydrate content of the diet. And this is the why do this? I mean, Jared Diamond once wrote that the agriculture was the worst mistake the human race had ever made. But the people who needed food would have said, look, agriculture is solving a problem for us. Some years ago, I was doing ethnographic work in Madagascar with some people who were part-time hunter-gatherers, but were largely horticulturalists. They were doing maize horticulture out in the forest, plus growing manioc in villages. And in order to grow maize in that in the forest, the Micaea forest, you have to cut the trees down. It's what we call slash and burn agriculture. And the soil is very, very poor. So you can get maybe two crops out of any given piece of land, and then you have to destroy some more forest. Well, the people I talked to would complain about the fact that there were no more lemurs to hunt in the forest. There were no more lemurs. And I never saw a lemur. Well, I only once saw a lemur in the wild. So they complained about this, and of course I pointed out to them, well, one of the reasons that there's no lemurs is because vast parts of the forest are now dead. It's just standing dead trees, which eventually get pushed over and burned as firewood. So that you can't have lemurs if you don't have a forest. So I pointed out this sort of conundrum, right? Right? You're complaining about lemurs, but you're the one cutting down the forest. Why do you do that? And this fellow looked at me as if I were an idiot, because in fact I was being an idiot. And he patted his stomach and said, "I'm hungry." And as this is where we get our food. So what do you want me to do? This is what I have to do. It's the same thing with me driving my car to work. I know I'm contributing to the climate change by dumping more carbon in the atmosphere, but I need to work to make food, to make money to buy food. What can I do? What can I do? It's a conundrum, not just of 20th century life. It's a conundrum that goes way back in time.
Yeah, maybe that makes us question that sort of hippie idea that hunter-gatherers or more traditional societies were in perfect harmony with nature or something like that.
Well, but they weren't in perfect harmony with nature. If they could live in harmony with nature, it's largely because they were present in very small numbers on the landscape. But they could still have an impact on the landscape. We see that in our archaeological sites, where certain resources, we can find evidence of the use of certain animals, and then they're not there, because they've actually been hunted, maybe perhaps to extinction, certainly to extirpation. I mean, they've been become locally extinct. They had an impact on their environment. The eucalyptus forests of northern Australia are there because the Australian native peoples would burn that environment off seasonally. It's possible that the extensive oak forests in the eastern United States are there because people in the past burned the forest off. And that's actually good for oak trees. Oak trees will colonize a recently burned environment. So everyone, going back quite far, humans have had an impact on their environment. It just hasn't been as dramatic or as fast as the current impact on the environment.
Mm-hmm. So now perhaps connecting things with the first beginning, that is the beginning of the state, and combining an agricultural basis of economy with the state. I mean, I've referred to some of the negative consequences that people talk about, negative consequences that derived from adopting agriculture. But then on the other hand, the combination of agricultural societies within states also contributed with some positive things, like, for example, the acceleration of agriculture, rates of innovation, and it was what allowed for the creation of science and the arts and so on.
Right? Yeah. Agriculture eventually, largely because of some technological innovations, frees up some people from subsistence pursuits. And that means they can do other things. And this is where the arts and sciences start to be pursued rapidly. It's not that there weren't artists or scientists earlier in time. There were. I mean, many of the things that hunter-gatherers learned about their environments, like the medicinal properties of plants, that's because there were scientists in those hunter-gatherer communities who were willing to experiment, perhaps on themselves, maybe on their brothers and sisters, I don't know, with different sorts of plants to see, do they have some effect on people? They were scientists. There were certainly artists. We see it in the rock art, for example, the fantastic rock art in places like Spain and France, just this unbelievable rock art. Those are artists on the order of Rembrandt and Da Vinci. You know, they're phenomenal. So those people have always been with us, but there hasn't been any way to really free them up full time in order to pursue certain things. Once that happens, then they're able to generate more ideas, more technology, and so on. There also became a greater need for it, because you needed technology in order to make agriculture more productive. And you could do it. I mean, agriculture responds to irrigation or fertilizers or the manipulation of plants. I mean, people were doing, there was genetically modified food in the distant past, not because somebody was manipulating the genes in a laboratory, but because they were selecting certain things to plant and certain things not to plant. So all of this, once agriculture appears, we do get an acceleration of technology and all sorts of ideas in the arts and the sciences. That, of course, increases once you have state societies where there's some individual who's willing to fully support artisans and scientists as part of their court, and they actually are requiring them to produce, either to produce art or to produce basically scientific, mathematical, architectural knowledge. And this is where we get an acceleration in architecture and the building of pyramids and arches, and somebody had to figure this stuff out, and they did.
Yeah. And that's perhaps where we get into the fifth beginning then, that is the one we're going through now with the advent of capitalism and the changing demographics and, I mean, the development of new technology and the kinds of war that we went through and things like globalization and climate change, that is a very important one. So, I mean, what would you call the fifth beginning? What does it really correspond to?
I think in order to talk about the fifth beginning, we actually have to talk a little bit about the fourth beginning, which is the appearance of state societies, the earliest of which appear about 5,000 years ago along the Tigris and Euphrates in the Middle East.
Yeah.
This is the appearance of societies that are hierarchically ranked, where there are individuals at the top who have ultimate control over everything that happens below them. There'll be a military class, there'll be a merchant class, and then there's the vast number of people who are the, for lack of a better term, the peasant class at the bottom, mm-hmm. the ones who are doing most of the work. And this appears sort of soon after, in evolutionary times, soon after the appearance of agriculture, because of agriculture's capacity to increase food production and to free some people up, but also because of an increase in the numbers of people on the landscape, a sort of constant bumping up of population against the capacity of its environment to take care of all of those people. And one of the ways you can deal with that is to make your land more productive. The other way is to take someone else's land. Yeah. And that's not, those people aren't going to give up their land peacefully, and that's where military might shows up. It's not that there was no violence before there were state societies. I can show you plenty of archaeological cases where there was violence in the distant past. But with states, we have something new. We have a class of people whose job it is to prosecute military campaigns, and the development of technology that's exclusively designed to kill people in large mm-hmm. in large numbers. And that technology just escalates over time. It goes back and forth. Someone invents one technology, an offensive technology. Someone develops a defensive technology. You develop armies. I develop hill forts. You come up with ways to throw burning bundles into my hill fort. I build the castle out of stone. I come up with cannons. I come up with bigger cannons. And it just goes on and on and on. Yeah. We still live in what I think are the last days of the fourth beginning. Okay. And we've escalated it to the point of nuclear weapons, and they're kind of an ending point. You can't really attack a country that has nuclear weapons, not directly, because even if you know that you can win the war with that country, you also know that all they have to do is drop one bomb. That's all they have to do. And they can decimate a city.
Yeah.
We unfortunately proved this twice. Mm-hmm. So there's a great fear that if you attack a country with nuclear weapons, they could take out Tokyo, they could take out Paris, they could take out London, and the world would be decimated by it, because we're now so intricately linked together that it would be financially decimated, that the dominoes would quickly fall all around the world. The 2008 crisis proved this, that the entire world is tightly linked together.
Mm-hmm.
So we live in that time, and then the fourth beginning is what really helped develop military technology. It developed the idea of nation states, which really became enshrined really in the 17th century. They're a relatively new invention, but they really go back in time to the empires of Alexander and the Romans. Those ideas were all created during the fourth beginning, and we still have them today. We're still living with them and acting as if they're natural. Mm-hmm. Because culture always believes that the way we've organized the world is the natural way.
Yeah.
It's the only way. What other way could there be? The great thing about archaeology is it shows us, wow, there's a lot of different ways to organize human life. So there's nothing written in stone about the way human life is organized today.
Right.
The fifth beginning is, the other thing we have to know is that the other four beginnings are all marked by a radical change in the human signature on the planet, by the appearance of stone tools, for the origins of culture, by the appearance of things like art and figurines and elaborate burials that are indicating some kind of ritual that's signaling religion, almost certainly. Then we've got agriculture with the appearance of plants that have never existed before, and the appearance of bigger villages, more permanent villages, sedentary villages. And then we have states that are marked by the appearance of vast public architecture, temples and government buildings and marketplaces, things that didn't exist previously. They're the sorts of things an archaeologist looks at and goes, wow, this, what's happening in along the Tigris-Euphrates 5,000 years ago, we've never seen this before in human history. This is the first time that it appears, these public architecture, big, serious, labor-intensive public architecture. Mm-hmm. We now live in a world where there's a radical change, a fifth radical change in the human signature on the planet. We can look at the United States is probably the best example. 150 years ago, only 150 years ago, if you could have lived where I live today in Wyoming, along the front range of the Rocky Mountains down into Denver, Colorado, these were just nomadic Native American camps here, very, very temporary structures. Only 150 years ago, that's what was there. Maybe some early settler houses. Just not much. 150 years later, there are millions of people living along the front range. Massive buildings. This all happened to an archaeologist. This just happens in the blink of an eye. It's remarkable. And if you fly across the country, there's not a square inch that hasn't been altered by human activity. It's all farmlands that have been, the fields are divided up, they're irrigated, there are roads everywhere. It's remarkable the extent to which the landscape has been transformed in only a few generations' time. Some of the biggest man-made structures in the world are garbage dumps. This has never happened before. We've never had, you know, Staten Island off New York is basically one humongous garbage dump. We have structures that are enormous. The pyramids in Egypt, Khufu's pyramid, was the tallest structure for 4,000 years. It held the record. And then that record is replaced by very, very quickly by the Eiffel Tower and the Empire State Building and on. Very, very quickly, structures got enormous, covering many acres, but also very, very tall. This is a remarkably fast change in the signature of human behavior. In the book, I talk about the shipwrecks. There are tens of thousands of shipwrecks. Almost all of them date to after AD 1500. There's a few in the Mediterranean off the coast of China. There's a few ships there, but the vast majority of ships date to after 1500, and the vast majority are actually date to after 1800. So that's the sort of thing an archaeologist looks at and goes, well, that's really, we've never seen this before in human history. There's things on the moon. That's never happened before in human history. And then if we start looking at climate indicators, we have a climate today that we haven't seen. The CO2 content of the atmosphere hasn't been where it is now for hundreds of thousands of years, maybe more than a million years today. This is remarkable. This is the kind of indicator that's like the boundary that separates the age of dinosaurs from the age of mammals. I mean, it's that serious a signature. So we're, from an archaeological point of view, I can't help but say we're in a fifth beginning. There is something radically changing here where the nature of human existence is going to change. Mm-hmm. Now, in the book, I say I don't like to predict what that's going to be for two reasons. One is that I know people have made predictions over the last century. 95% of them turn out to be wrong. I'm not going to fall into that trap. But also, I don't see any value in making a prediction. You're assuming we have no influence here. The future is just coming at us, and whatever it is, it's already there. The future is ours to make. That's the simple truth. The future is ours to make. There's no point in predicting it. Let's create it.
Mm-hmm. But even if you don't want to make any specific predictions, because as you said, the fact that nowadays we live mostly in nations and that is not written in stone, because as we look back in history, we've lived in many different kinds of social organizations and things like that in different kinds of societies. Are you in some way optimistic about the future in terms of us being able to tackle some very important global scale problems like climate change?
Yeah, I choose to be optimistic. Yeah. Simply because if one is not optimistic, then there's no point in trying. I've read many books about the near future. Many of them revolve around climate change, and their final chapter says, well, we could do something about this if we had the political will, but we don't. So basically, That's it. We're doomed. And when I read a book like that, I go, well, okay, I'm gonna go party. What else is there to do? Might as well have fun while the world is ending. So that very pessimistic approach to me leads to inaction. So I prefer to keep saying, yeah, there's something we can do about it, and it's within our grasp. We can do it. Now, the week that my book was published was the week that Donald Trump was elected president.
Oh my God.
Yes, this was very depressing for me. I admit that. I said, oh, I'm completely wrong. We are doomed. And it was also at the same time that Britain had its vote to leave the European Union, which now it's going to happen at the end of this month, which is a terrible disappointment to me, along with the election of Trump. These are terribly disappointing things. We're seeing the rise of right-wing nationalist governments in several places, in Hungary, in Turkey, it's in Brazil, the Philippines. It's very depressing, and I think it's a logical consequence of some of the processes that are at work that could, in fact, bring about the end of a nation state. And I don't want to say that nations won't exist. I think that they will exist for a long, long time, but they'll merely be sort of record-keeping devices to figure out how resources are distributed and where do we need to redistribute some resources. They're just a way to maintain spatial records across the globe. But one of the things that has happened in the 20th century is enormous numbers of refugees moving around the globe, moving around as a product of wars, moving around as a product of capitalism just doing what capitalism does, moving workers around the world, people moving because they've been displaced by wars or by the collapse of economies, or now we can add to it climate change. That's going to, in the next decade or two, is going to move a lot of people around the globe. Mm-hmm. And this is an uncomfortable fact for many people, because they're uncomfortable with somebody of a different culture living just down the street from them.
Yeah.
There may not be any good reason for that. As an anthropologist, I ask myself, how come people just can't chill out and be okay with the fact that there's maybe Somali Muslims living down the street? What's the problem, right? But for many people, it is a problem. Brexit was largely driven by people not happy with all of the Eastern Europeans that were freely able to move into Britain. And they were moving into Britain because economically that's their best choice. You can't blame them. Trump was elected largely on the fear that many Americans have of the influx of immigrants from Mexico, Central America, but also the presence of Muslim immigrants in the country. These fears are largely baseless. I mean, studies have been done. I mean, Trump said, you know, they're criminals. Well, we can look at the statistics on this, and actually, no. The rate of crime in the immigrant communities is lower than the overall rate of crime in the United States. They're not contributing to it. But still people have this fear. And we have to recognize it, and somehow politicians have to deal with that. But the the appearance of these right-wing nationalistic wall-building politicians is largely a product of the fact that people are moving around the globe in larger numbers than ever as a logical result of capitalism, warfare, and climate change. Mm-hmm. And it's not, it will not stop. It's not going to stop. Mm-hmm. So either we can continue to build up bigger and bigger walls, or we accept the fact that every community in the world is going to be a diverse one. Mm-hmm. And I don't think there's any way to solve that problem. It's hard for me to go to neighbors and say, hey, yeah, there's, we now have a, you know, a Muslim community in town. Chill out, you know, relax. It's not a problem. You can't really tell that to people. But if you have generations that grow up with diversity, then that becomes the new normal. It becomes, yeah, of course it's normal. My son's play group when he was a teenager, his sort of group of kids, my son is adopted, both of my sons are adopted, and they're both African-American. So one of them, his play group consisted of a Muslim boy and a Mongolian a boy, and then a white kid. And those were the four that sort of ran around with each other. These are kids who are going to grow up in a world where, yeah, of course my playmates are Muslim or Mongolian or black or what. They're going to be accustomed to diversity. It won't be easy, and we have to wait for that generation to grow up and get into positions of authority. Mm-hmm. But I'm hopeful that will change things. We'll get a new generation that has a new culture, a new cultural idea about what the what a proper world looks like. And to them, a proper world is one in which there's diversity, even in the smallest communities in rural Wyoming. You'll find you can expect diversity, and that's okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's see what happens in the future then. So the last topic I would like to explore with you, because I mean, this is very interesting to me. I've already had several anthropologists on the show, and this, I guess, is a very important thing to discuss in anthropology. So when we talk about hunter-gatherers, I mean, we are sort of using the word as if those kinds of societies had some sort were in any form uniform or homogeneous, or had some sort of features that they shared, or all the features are equal among themselves, or at least most of them, and we have the men hunting and the women gathering and this and that. But I mean, one of the things that I learned by reading your books is that we have to be very careful when thinking about not only what a hunter-gatherer society is about, but also what we can extrapolate from a particular hunter-gatherer society to other societies, and even more specifically to human nature, right?
Oh, human nature, that always opens a can of worms, because I think human nature is extraordinarily malleable, right? This is what culture is all about. It changes the way that we think about the world, and that has an impact on what people do. So I've never been very enthusiastic about discussions of human nature. The point I made when I wrote my hunter-gatherer book years ago, yeah. The point I made there was that there's a lot of diversity among the people who live by hunting and gathering. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't any effort to say, here's what hunter-gatherers are really like, invariably has to push aside some of the diversity that we know exists among hunter-gatherers.
Yeah.
That to me is not a productive strategy, because it's looking for a sort of essential hunter-gatherer, and it's missing the opportunity to understand why is there diversity in some area of human behavior. So you can find hunter-gatherers who are very, very egalitarian, where everyone is more or less equal, and you can find hunter-gatherers that are basically chiefdom-like societies, where there's a stratification developing and where some individuals have more authority and power than other people.
Yeah.
So by putting them aside, and anthropologists did years ago, they sort of put them aside and said, well, those hunter-gatherers live in extraordinary environments, so we'll just put them aside. I look at that and go, well, what's extraordinary about that environment, that it produced something very different than what we see among these other hunter-gatherers who apparently don't live in extraordinary environments? So I thought we were missing an opportunity to learn something by winnowing out the variation. But after I wrote that book, another colleague asked me, she said, is there anything about hunter-gatherers, ethnographically known hunter-gatherers, is there anything about them that you think can be extrapolated into the past?
Mm-hmm.
And at the time I said, well, there's really only one thing that I can think of, which is men hunt large animals and women gather plants and will take smaller game.
Yeah.
And that is a strong pattern across all the diversity of hunter-gatherer societies. Doesn't matter where we are, tropics, Arctic, very egalitarian, non-egalitarian, men do the hunting and women do the gathering.
Yeah.
It's a very strong empirical pattern. And in the book I say I think the explanation for it really has to do with childcare and in particular breastfeeding. Children in hunting and gathering societies can breastfeed for 3 or 4 or more years. That can be a very important source of nutrition for them.
Yeah.
Having a breastfeeding child with you is incompatible with hunting animals. And this is not my idea. It's actually an idea that goes back to Judith Brown in the 1970s, that it's just incompatible. Because if you have to breastfeed a child, especially if you're doing on-demand breastfeeding, that is, the child decides when they're going to breastfeed, which if children do that, they'll do it very, very frequently for short bouts throughout the day.
That's a very interesting point. Let me just interrupt you there for a second. So would you say then that one of the reasons why women don't hunt doesn't have anything to do with their physical traits, because that's one of the things that we associate with men and hunting, the physical differences in terms of athleticism and physical prowess and other things?
No, it doesn't. Hunting requires a great deal of knowledge, which anyone could acquire. It requires patience, it requires stealth, and that's really what it requires, especially if you're bow hunting. It just requires a lot of patience and stealth and knowledge. And that's really why it's not compatible with taking children along, because children are going to make noise. They're going to cry. You're going to need to stop and deal with them. And when you're hunting, the animal is dictating what happens. Especially if you've already hit it and you're going to now follow the blood trail to get to that animal really before it dies, because once it dies, if you don't get there soon, the scavengers are going to be on top of it.
Yeah.
So you want to be there in order to finish it off. So you can't have a child along with you. When I was in Madagascar and I would ask men if I could go hunting with them, and they're hunting small animals,
yeah.
They one time they said, well, they said to my Malagasy interpreter, they said, no, he's going to get tired, and he'll want to go back to camp, and he'll make noise. And in other words, they were afraid I would act like a child. Because from their perspective, I was a child. And in fact, I was, because I didn't know anything that they thought a man ought to know. So they didn't want to take me because I would act like a child. And so that's the reason why I think it's a strong cross-cultural empirical pattern, because everywhere women breastfeed children. It's an obvious universal. So I think that's the only thing I think we can assume to have been true in the past. It doesn't mean that women wouldn't have played a role, especially if they're doing group drives of animals. The women can play a role as the beaters, who are the ones making the noise to drive animals into nets or into some impoundment. But they can also be the people at the other end who are going to be helping to dispatch those animals once they've caught them in a trap. They can completely participate in that. And there's plenty of ethnographic accounts of them doing exactly that.
But even if that's the only social feature, let's say, that you say that we can solidly extrapolate to hunter-gatherer societies of the past from modern ones, are there any other so-called human universals that you accept exist in modern hunter-gatherer societies?
I've thought about this some more, whether that's, if my colleague asked me this question, what could you extrapolate into the past, if there's anything else. And one of the things that's true about hunter-gatherers is that they do live in fairly small communities. We may be talking about a group of maybe 18 to 25 people. That's fairly common across many hunting and gathering groups living in very different environments. They tend to be certainly less than 30 people living in one residential group. It's several families, obviously. But even if you get into larger communities, you may be talking about several hundred people, but they're not living in communities of thousands of people. And what this means is that in hunter-gatherer communities, everyone can respond to everyone else as individuals, not as somebody in an office. When you and I interact with a police officer on the street, we don't know who that police officer is. It's unlikely that we will know who that police officer is. We respond to them not as an individual with a particular personality, but as someone occupying a particular office. That's probably less true among hunter-gatherers for the ethnographic communities, but also in the past. They could respond to people all as individuals. And that gives a community a little different flavor. And you see it sometimes in small towns. I see it in small rural towns in Wyoming, where it is possible for everyone to know everyone else. There are some very small towns in Wyoming. They're made up of 20 or 30 people. They all know each other as individuals, and they can deal with everybody as an individual. That's one of the other things that I think is true about hunter-gatherers, is the idea of offices doesn't really exist. They can deal with people as individuals.
But that's another one of the things that we can extrapolate to hunter-gatherers of the past,
Of the past,
correct?
yes.
But in terms of modern hunter-gatherers, just looking at those, Do you think that there are any other human universals that we could consider?
I don't think you'd see any human universals among hunter-gatherers that you wouldn't see among other kinds of societies, industrial societies. I don't think that hunter-gatherers are going to reveal human nature any more than people living in any other kind of society. In the beginning, anthropologists thought that they could see human nature among hunter-gatherers because all of the distracting elements of modern industrial society were removed from them. Hunter-gatherers have as many distracting elements in their society as industrial societies do.
Also because they've been previously in touch with modern societies. That's one of the reasons.
Early on in the 60s, anthropologists thought they could try and remove the effects of those contacts with agricultural or industrial societies. They thought they could remove them. You can't really do that. You can't really remove a it's all intricately interwoven, and you can't take one element out and think, oh, now I'm looking at how these people lived before they had contact with non-hunting and gathering societies. I don't think we can really do that. It's
Okay.
not like going into a lab and mixing some chemicals together and go, okay, what happens if we remove this chemical? Let's see what happens. You can't really do that with human societies.
Okay, so let me ask you one last question. You are certainly familiar with the disciplines of evolutionary psychology, human behavioral ecology, and others. And I mean, particularly when it comes to evolutionary psychology, I remember that in his book, The Blank Slate, Steven Pinker even includes in the appendix a huge list of human universals that were put together, I guess, by Donald Brown in the early 90s. And I mean, people in evolutionary psychology are interested in trying to understand what are the features of our human mind that are universal, that all people across the world share. So, do you think that, I mean, from an anthropological, archaeological perspective, the perspective that you have, and considering the variability across societies, even the hunter-gatherer ones, do you think that we can talk about that sort of thing, about what they would probably call a human nature?
And I have to be honest here. I've never been that interested in human universals or in discussions of human nature. It's because I find the diversity more interesting. But I do have to admit that the diversity may be built upon some simple human universals. So I find the diversity in marriage customs around the world or among hunter-gatherers to be what's interesting. But someone else would say, underlying that is this universal that all societies have something that in English we would call marriage. It's very, very different, but they all have something like that. So why is that? One can ask that question. It's just never been a question that I've really found that interesting. So I've never Yeah, just never given much thought to human universals. I'm more interested in the diversity, but I admit that underlying it are some interesting facts that demonstrate that there's some universals that underlie the diversity in behavior.
Well, I don't know if that would count for you, but earlier in the interview you referred to Stephen Mithen's modules of the mind, the four modules, so that could probably be considered at least one approach to the human mind that considers that all humans have at least these four modules, if not others. So.
And there may be others. The whole field of evolutionary psychology postulates that there are many different modules. Now, I'll also have to admit here that I sort of stopped reading evolutionary psychology some years back.
Okay.
Because I found its understanding of hunter-gatherers to be embarrassing. There was, for example, and I found some of their laboratory procedures to be, well, actually silly. So I sort of stopped reading the literature.
Yeah.
They didn't know anything about hunter-gatherers. Mm-hmm. And they didn't know anything about culture. And some of them were embarrassing. Mm-hmm. I once sat in on a course here with an evolutionary psychologist who said, he told his seminar, he said, if I took any of you to the Arctic and just dropped you in there, he said, you would be dead within 24 hours. He's probably right, especially if it was the winter. And he said you'd be dead within 24 hours because you don't know how to make a living there, unlike the Inuit. Yeah. You don't know how to make a living there, and you wouldn't be able to figure it out quickly enough.
Yeah.
But he said if you were to take Inuit and put them in New York City, he said they would be able to figure it out. And I thought, wow. And he said they would be able to figure out and they would be fine. And I had to say, I had to raise my hand and say, you know, your experiment, half of your experiment has actually been done. Because about 1897, I believe, the anthropologist Franz Boas had several Greenland Eskimos, I believe it was seven, brought down from Greenland to New York City, probably. Mm-hmm. 19th, early 20th century. I forget exactly what year it was, but I've been in the room where those Greenland Inuit lived when they were at the American Museum. They were utterly terrified. They had no idea what everything was around them. They'd never seen trains, horses, vast numbers of people, incredibly tall buildings from their perspective, so much action and commotion. They were utterly freaked out, and they didn't want to leave the museum. They didn't want to go out there. They begged and pleaded to go home. Several of them died of tuberculosis rather quickly. One of them, they were able to get onto a ship going back to Greenland. As you can imagine, there weren't that many ships going to Greenland.
Yeah.
And one of them was a 10-year-old boy named Minnick, who there's a book about his life. Yeah. It's tragic, utterly tragic. He ended up being raised mostly in rural New York State. His father died there in New York. His body was actually rendered down for its skeletal remains. And Minnick tried repeatedly to get back to Greenland, once set off on foot, got up into Canada, but he wasn't going to make it to Greenland. And he eventually died at about the age of 30 and working in the as a logger in the Maine woods. It's a tragic life, tragic. But the point was, the experiment had been done. Half of it had been done. And it didn't work the way this evolutionary psychologist was arguing that it was going to work. He was operating with some ideas that hunting and gathering people were just like our ancient ancestors, and our ancient ancestors were smarter than we were today, which is nonsense. We're no smarter than them. We know more collectively. We know more, but they actually knew a lot too of things that you and I don't know. I don't know how to spear seals through their holes in the ice. So they knew different things, but it's not as if they had some intellectual capacity that was greater than ours today. So there have been other embarrassments too, things like, there was for a while there were a number of papers written about how men and women figured space differently. The argument was that women memorize space and men have a kind of vector-based reasoning for it. And they proved this through experiments that they could do in the lab. Mm-hmm. And I kept reading these experiments and saying, my goodness, why don't you take some people out in the woods and do an experiment out there? Someone finally did that, actually. And their results suggested that there is a male-female difference in how they reckon space. But their argument for it was that women gather plants, and so they have to memorize where plants are in the landscape. Men do hunting, and so they have to calculate where an animal is going to be at some point during the day, and then they can take the short route, basically. Instead of following the path of the animal, they go to where they can predict the animal is going to be. I couldn't see any reason why men wouldn't have, why it wouldn't be any more important for men to memorize landscapes. And I can tell you that I had experience with seeing women, hunter-gatherers, do vector-based reasoning to get back to camp. Mm-hmm. So it struck me that their vision of what was causing this alleged difference in male-female differences in the way that they reckon space, I'll leave aside whether they've actually got that right or not, but certainly their explanation for it for hunting and gathering peoples betrayed a lack of any experience with the hunting and gathering day-to-day life. It simply wasn't what they said to be true. Simply wasn't true, not in my experience and not in the experience of many other ethnographers of hunter-gatherers. Mm-hmm. So I found it to be kind of embarrassing. There was once the study which said, explain the association of blue with men and red with women, or pink with women, which is a classic color association in the United States. I don't know if it's true in Europe or not. But they argued that women, because of their ancient past as the gatherers, had to recognize the red berries. So
the red apples or something like
yes,
that.
Yes, yes. And I read this study, and of course, a century ago or so, that color association was reversed. I don't know why it switched, but more than a century ago, that color association of blue with males and pink with girls had been reversed.
Yeah.
So. And anyone who knows something about foraging in the woods knows that the red berries are often the poisonous ones. They're often not the ones you want to eat. I read that and said, my God, this is so naive on a number of levels, not knowing anything about foraging and not knowing anything about the culture of color association in American society. It was rather embarrassing. So I've not been that excited about evolutionary psychology. Perhaps I should go see what it's doing today. I'm more inclined to think that the mind is a generalized problem-solving device and isn't comprised of the dozens of modules that the evolutionary psychologists are proposing.
Mm-hmm. So perhaps going back to that modularity of mind proposed by Stephen Mithen, you would agree more with domain general modules and a small number of them instead of
yes.
hundreds of specialized domain specific modules.
Correct. Yeah. Yeah, I think it's more generalized, maybe a few of these major modules. But I'll also admit that we don't know the answer to that yet.
Okay, so Dr. Kelly, we've already had a very long discussion here. We've covered a lot of ground, and I thank you for your time. So I will be leaving links to your work and to your books in the description box of the interview,
thank
both
you.
For the video and the podcast version. Would you like to make mention to some places on the internet where people can find your work or not?
Oh, they can go to my own faculty page at the University of Wyoming, but like many faculty, I don't keep it really up to date. To look for my books, those can be relatively easily found through Amazon or just Google the fifth beginning Robert Kelly, and you'll get to it. That's the only book I've written for the general public. It was not written for professionals. It's written for the lay reader.
Yeah.
It's been translated into Chinese, and it's being translated into Korean, and it will be available in German this summer.
Mm-hmm.
I'd love to see it in Portuguese. So if you know a publisher, and it's really is designed for the lay person. I think it's a pretty good read. It's a short book.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I really loved it, and I recommend it to all my listeners and viewers. So.
Oh, thanks.
Okay, so Dr. Kelly, thank you a lot again for taking
time.
You've been very generous with your time, and I really love the conversation, so thank you.
Oh, thank you for the opportunity.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for watching this interview until the end. As you might have noticed, I've been putting out regular interviews with leading intellectuals from around the world. And so, to keep the channel sustainable, I would really like to ask you to please visit my Patreon page and to consider making a pledge there. Otherwise, and if you like what I'm doing, please share it, leave a like, and hit the subscription button. You can also support me via PayPal. I would also like to give a huge thank you to my patrons, Karen Litzke, Anne Blanchett, Perga Larsen, Lau Guerrero, Chantel Gelinas, Francis Ford, Hans Frederick Sunda, Brian Rivera, Sergio Condriano, Janne Henninen, Ricardo Vladimiro, Craig Healy, Adam Castle, Vega Giddy, Olaf Alex, Jonathan Wiesel, David Diaz, Anian Kata, Jacob Klinkby, Matthew Whittingbird, Arno Wolf, Tim Hollacy, Henrik Alenius, John Connors, Drs. Jerry Mueller, Herbert Gintis, Rutger Voss, and Bo Weingart, my four producers, Izar Webbe, Rosie, Jim Frank, and Lucas Stafiniak, and my executive producer, Michel Rugieski. Thank you for all.